So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this session on PEEP optimization. And it's great to see so many people here, because every time we're going to have PEEP on the program, there's a lot of people. I mean, we're discussing this topic like for decades. And now, finally, I hope at the end of the session, we will have the answer how to set PEEP in your patient. Actually, we're not going to leave the room before we have an answer, right? It's a pleasure and honor to co-chair this session with Jeremy Beichler from Columbia University in New York. My name is Leo Hunks, pulmonologist intensivist from Nijmegen, the Netherlands. For people, there's still two seats right here. So if you want to sit right here, take a chair. And it's my real pleasure and honor to introduce the first speaker, who actually doesn't need an introduction, but it's Professor Luciano Gattinoni from Göttingen. And he will discuss whether we should first assess recruitability before setting PEEP. Please, Professor Gattinoni.
Okay, hi. You stand. See you. No, what? How to set PEEP? Okay, it's a long story because since the beginning of RDS, so in the 67, 68, this was one of the main topic, and a lot of people miss this is something that you have to deal every day with. Now, why we use PEEP? We have first to question this one. And the answer is quite easily, because we have the benefits, the expected benefits is the PO2. And the PCO2, nobody cares. Because sometimes you have the PO2 goes up, PCO2 goes to 50, 60. But PCO2 is completely ignored. I remind you that 50, 60 means hypoventilation. And hypoventilation is something not normal. And then we may have some PEEP action on prevention of atelectasis trauma. Now, the atelectasis trauma story is something, is a dogma that we have since the last 20 years. And everything starts with a theoretical paper of Mead about the stress strain, and editorial of Lachman on intensive care, open the lung and keep it open. And we continue to use, and the study of Ranieri, you found some decrease in cytokine using, looking at the possible atelectasis trauma. But there are not many things, really, about that. So my recommendation is never take something for granted. Use the brain instead of the guidelines. Anyway, hemodynamics, the risk are quite easy. Hemodynamic, stress strain, and water retention. And more advanced in the years, and the last years we just concentrated on the animals study, it's very clear that the PEEP is a tremendous obstacle to circulation. And I think Jose Jardin, no, since 30 years ago, they never used a PEEP, I think, greater than 10, because they were using the echo. And looking at the echo, say, you put more than 10, my heart explode. Think to that. We cannot play with a ventilator without looking at hemodynamics, urine output, and water retention. You may have a patient that after 2-3 days have gained 4, 5, 6 kilos, which is not indifferent. Now, increasing PEEP, of course, we increase the PO2. In 95% of the cases, if I put a lot of PEEP, the PO2 goes up. But sometimes the cardiac output goes down, and very go down. And see, the cardiac output cannot be separated. When you, any time you use a PEEP and you touch the ventilator, think to the hemodynamics, to the central venous saturation and so on. And of course, we increase the possible. The advantages increasing PEEP are worse than disadvantages, a lower advantage than the disadvantages. And the PEEP story I don't want to go through, but we start at the beginning with PEEP and hemodynamics, the suture. Then we start with the lung mechanics. And we think, okay, we have at the beginning of the volume pressure curve, you have recruitability, then you have the innocent part, and then you have overdistension, which is wrong. Then we have the CT scan. Then we have other system, but still after 40, 50 years, we are still looking at. And then we have the guideline, great. And the guideline, you take the guideline of the ESICM, and you take the, what people have two sex, who knows? Do whatever you want. Basically, this is what is said. We don't have any recommendation. And the ATS, it said, well, use higher PEEP in moderate and severe RDS, that means in RDS. And what is higher PEEP? Greater than 15? Greater than 10? Let's see. Not looking at statistics that I never understood, the bias and the mediation analysis, four pages of statistics to explain, something which is very clear. The benefit of low PEEP, low PEEP I mean around 7, as done in the three major study, versus the benefits of PEEP around 12, the higher PEEP in the same study, alveoli, express and lower, we don't have any difference. Then you may play with the statistic as you want. But these are the basic results. And that means that the risk and benefits within this range are the same in the general population. But remember, the randomized trials, when they look at the population, not to the single patient that you have to take care of. And then this is not very quoted paper because it's a little bit against the current thinking, but when you increase the PEEP and maybe you put some recruitment maneuver and so on, you may have some fraction of the patient, you will experience a bad outcome. And these are when a study, or my study, is positive, that means you get something, means far more than when it's negative. So be careful when you play with the knobs. And I remind you that the PEEP FiO2 table with 40% of oxygen, if the PEEP is lower than, I think, 80, around between 55 and 80, the PEEP recommended is 16. And I think the COVID experience was terrible in that sense, because recruitability. Recruitability, we have two main methods. One is method which is based with the several variation, but not substantial variation, about what do you expect and what you measure. You expect some increase of lung gas volume when you increase the PEEP and so on. If you find more than expect according to the compliance and so on, all this is recruitment. And then you have the CT method. And the CT method tell you which are the units, the pulmonary units, which were without any gas and regain inflation. And are two different, completely two different world. And two different, we have big differences in that. But we use the recruitability as a unique word. And we have a completely under reality behind. This is the gas method. We did this in 88, I think, many, many years ago, the past century, in which we have in RDS pulmonary, extrapulmonary, don't look at pulmonary, extrapulmonary, but this just to the gas method. No? You expect something on the right, and you have something different, and this is computed as a recruitment. And this is the other one based on the double volume pressure curve, but the concepts are exactly the same. And these are the inflation ratio, no? This brochure which speak, I suppose, about that, which is correlated with the PO2, but it's not enthusiastic correlation. Look at the R square R is 0.2, 0.3, something like that. And then we have the CT scan. A CT scan measures the recruitability, which is far lower, because about 10%, 13% as average. With a gas method, you may have 40, 50%. But what is the main difference? Very simple. With a CT scan, you compute how much the pulmonary units which regain inflation from zero. Why? With the gas method, you count this unit plus the unit that a lower PEEP had less favorable compliance, that means the poorly aerated and so on. They are computed as recruitability. It's important to know that. Okay? And then, as an example, the COVID. Here, the COVID is quite impressive when you have a PO2, a FiO2 lower than 100 and so on, and the recruitability is exactly the same with a CT scan as the people without with a PO2, a FiO2 greater than 300. But still, the people looking at the table take a PEEP and use maybe 15, 16, 20 of PEEP in these patients, with some problem in 24 hours with kidney, hemodynamics, and so, particularly during the first wave. And then, recruitment. You cannot speak about recruitment without speaking about the opening pressure. Because the recruitment does not occur just in one part. It is continuous, as the inflation curve. These are dogs, and you see, these are dog done by my friend Pelosi with the Marini Lab. These are Deutsche Schwein, these are pigs done by Quinter. You see the recruitment from zero up to the very high pressure, 40 and so on, is a continuous process. And these are patients done in Milan, very few patients. What is important message? That if I increase the pressure up to 40, and then even after to 60, some fraction of the lung is open. And then to keep it open, I cannot separate PEEP opening from keeping open. PEEP does not recruit. What recruit is the opening pressure. PEEP maintain the potential recruitment. This is an other example of the recruitability in opening pressures. Now, I don't want to spend time here because we have only 15 minutes, but this tells you how the recruitability is done now in with the CT. Not much, but it's quite important. But if I plot the CT versus the gas methods, I don't have practically any correlation. Extremely poor correlation. So when you speak about recruitability, and I have to look what kind of method has been used. So if you like, take the common wisdom, this higher is the recruitability, higher is the PEEP that you must use. That means if the recruitability is greater, the pressure to keep the lung open must be greater. It's true. Why should be? So, let's see the opening pressure. Opening pressure, I need some pressure to overcome the surface forces, 15 to 20 centimeter of water, to overcome the gravitational forces of the lung, which is about 10, 15 in an adult centimeter of water, and to lift up the chest wall, 5 to 10. If you make the sum, the recruitability is around 40, 45. Then you may have some other factor, and a little fraction may be higher than that. And then the closing pressure, you need to keep open, you need the pressure which is lower than opening pressure. But let's see, I recruit with opening pressure of 45. And then I set the PEEP at 15. And you say that the opening and closing is not very different from if I use a 20 of opening pressure and a PEEP of 5. Because remember, to keep open one unit or to keep open 1,000 units, the pressure is exactly the same. Recruitability is a function of the disease, is the number of units which are atelectatic, let's say with the CT scan, or in a worse condition in not with the CT scan. But to keep one open and 1,000 open is exactly the same. It's the difference between the intensity and the extensive probability of one system. So this, and this is my last slide. Yes, I think I'm on time. And you see, I put, I think this will appear is impressed. If I use to keep open, this represents the poorly aerated tissue or the complete collapsed tissue. And you see, it's a complicated figure just to show one thing, that you need the same pressure to keep one open and 1,000 open. So at the end of the story is, how can I balance all this kind of thing? Remember that to keep a lung completely open, keep the lung open, you need the pressure greater than 20, around 25. At 25 of pressure, your lung expansion is close to the total lung capacity. Total lung capacity means that the blood to be pumped through this lung has some problem. That means the kidney response, that means the water retention, etc., etc., etc. And then if I use a recruitment maneuver of 45 and then I put the plateau at 30, in a few minutes, I will de-recruit until... So that means that in our normal life, we have to keep part of the lung always closed. We like or we dislike, this is the reality, unless you use some people, which is horrible. The benefits are lower than the risk. So after 50 years, we are playing with this. If somebody asks me, okay, so good, what kind of people I have to use? Friday night, put 10. And look at SVO2. And why 10? Because we are not Sumerian. If not, we would say 12. 10 is okay. Because 10 is not too high and is not too low. And is what, regardless the guidelines, most of the people use around the world. So use always your brain, be careful with the guidelines, and be careful with the experts. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gattinardi. Maybe we have time for one short question, if anybody has one. Anybody? I think thank you so much for your presentation. I think in the interest of time, we'll try to move on. Thank you so much, Dr. Gattinardi.
Okay.
It's a pleasure to welcome next Dr. Michelle Slama, who's going to talk about titrating PEEP above the airway opening pressure. Thank you so much, Dr. Slama, for joining us.
So that will be hard after the presentation of Luciano. So I will try to convince you to set the PEEP at least above the airway opening pressure. So what that? The closure of the small airways involving the whole lung during deflation and induce no communication between airways and alveoli, and the threshold for reopening the collapsed airway is what we call airway opening pressure. If you look at patients with ARDS, so the prevalence of the AOP, of the clotture, of airway clotture, is from 20 up to 44, demonstrated by Clément Brault in our unit. And it's a common phenomenon, and the prevalence is higher in obese patients, and the median of AOP is between 8 to 10. And you can find airway clotture, not only in ARDS, but as well in other clinical situations. So, which is the location of this clotture? There are many studies trying to find out where is that. So this paper of Malatesta demonstrated by doing a fibroscopy, bronchoscopy, that it may be more proximal clotture with a segmental bronchi clotture, as you can see on left-hand side of the slide. And right-hand side, it's an animal study demonstrated that it could be involve maybe a distal bronchi, so distal clotture, and so the debate is not closed for that. This study was done in our unit by Clément Brault, and he assessed the AOP, the clotture, the airway clotture, in 68 patients over the time at day 1, day 3, day 5, day 7, day 9. And he demonstrated that in almost 30% of cases, there was an AOP above 5 centimeters of water. But if you look at that, at the day 5, almost more than 50% of patients demonstrated an AOP. And which is very interesting is that a dynamic phenomena. It means that, for example, here 4 patients did not have any airway clotture when we assessed this AOP at day 1, and they demonstrated an airway clotture later on during the follow-up at day 3 or at day 5. So which are the possible cause of this airway clotture? Parietal factors, bronchial hypertrophy, bronchoconstriction induced by cytokines, external factors, loss of elastic recoil, bronchial compression by the lung or by the chest, and sometimes intraluminal factors like surfactant impairment of fluid accumulation. So let's see this cause. First, the parietal factors. There is 2 studies. The first one in autopsic lung tissue, 20 patients with ARDS, 11 patient control. And you see that the thickness of the airways is thicker in a patient with ARDS. And if you look at the outer layer, so you have a deposit of a lot of substance on it, like a collagen, for example. And in a lower part of this slide, this is an animal study. They took a rat lung slice. They incubated this slice with TNF alpha and interleukin 1 beta, and they demonstrated an obstruction of the bronchoobstruction on this slice. So it means that maybe this parietal factor has a role on this phenomena of airway clotture. Intraluminal factor as well, very nice study of Coudroy, demonstrated that the surfactant is very important. On left-hand side, the phospholipid A2 is low. It means that the surfactant is normal. And you see that the PLA2 is low in patient with no airway clotture. In contrast with patient with an airway clotture in which the PLA2 is high, so it means a much lower surfactant and a high surface tension. Of course, if you have a BMI too high, so you have a higher risk to have an airway clotture, but if you look at the mean AOP, it doesn't change even if you have a BMI above 40. So Clément Brault, again, in these studies that he has done in our unit, tried to check if the lung water is associated with airway clotture, but unfortunately, neither daily balance, nor body weight, nor difference of proteinemia or hematocrit had any difference between patients with or without airway clotture. So, but how to detect this complete airway clotture? I told you that you have to set the PEEP above that. So there is the first method. This first method, you use a low flow insufflation for that. Of course, you have to have a patient of course, with a sedation, no inspiratory effort, no respiratory effort. And then you will reduce the respiratory rate down to 8 per minute. You have to check if there is no PEEP, because after that you will have a force measurement. You have to decrease the PEEP down to 5 centimeters of water, and reduce the inspiratory flow to 6 liters per minute to avoid any resistance of to the flow. And then, at that time, you know that many respirators may have this volume pressure curve, and on left-hand side there is no airway closure because you have only one slope without any abrupt change of this slope. And on right-hand side, you have an abrupt change of the slope, which between the two slopes, you have the AOP, which is here 9.5. As well, it's possible to use the relation between the pressure and the time. And again, if you have no rupture of the slope, so you have no airway closure. In contrast, if you have two different slopes with an abrupt rupture, and at this point, this is the AOP that you measured. So again, Clément Brault tried to assess the tolerance of this maneuver, because of course you decrease the PEEP, you may decrease the patient, and so he demonstrated that the SpO2 decreased during this maneuver and was also lower than at the baseline 10 minutes after this maneuver. So it's something, but fortunately, we did not find any change on heart rate and mean arterial pressure. And now he compared AOP and patient with AOP and without AOP during and after this maneuver, and you see that when the patient has an AOP, so it was much less tolerated than patient without AOP. But there is another method to assess this AOP without changing the inspiratory flow and leaving the flow at, let's say, 60 liters per minute. And you see on the left-hand side, this is the pressure curve that you know. And the resistive pressure, as you know as well, at the end of the insufflation, the insufflation stop, and then the pressure decreased to the plateau pressure. So it is we used to say that it is a resistive pressure. And if the resistive pressure is equal to the other pressure at which we have a rupture of the slope during an inspiratory phase, so it means that you have no airway closure. In contrast, if you have a discrepancy between both, so it means that what they call the conductive pressure is much higher than the resistive pressure, it's possible to calculate the AOP by doing a P conductive minus a P resistive, and you add, of course, the PEEP to have the AOP. And he demonstrated, this team demonstrated, Audebourg, that it was really correlated to the low flow method, and of course much more better tolerated than the low flow method. So which are the clinical implications for the presence of this airway closure? Of course, it is very important if you want to monitor your patient, because all the measurement will be false, because the PEEP will be false, the compliance will be false, and then that's why you have really to keep in mind that you have to check for this AOP. Of course, you will have some lung consequences, like bronchial trauma, of course, opening and closing the lung, ventilation perfusion mismatch, denitrogenation atelectasis as well. And for the management, sometimes it would be very hard because it could reduce the actions of inhaled therapy. So I would like to show you this case that Clément Brault has done in our unit, trying to assess if the regional mechanical properties are the same as that what we get when we assess a general AOP. So on the left-hand side, he got the AOP on the entire lung, and it was 5.4. And then by using the EIT, it was possible to assess the AOP at the anterior part of the lung, which was 5.2, and posterior part of the lung, and it was very high, 10.3. But unfortunately, it was not possible to assess that if you just assess the global lung, because if you look at your in the left-hand side of the slide, you see that the AOP corresponds to the lowest IOP when you assess the regional AOP of the patient. And it was well demonstrated by this beautiful study of Jose. And again, he tried to assess patient with an asymmetric ARDS. You see that the left lung seems almost normal, but the right is really pathologic. And he assessed the AOP at in the lung. It was 3 centimeters of water. Then with the EIT, he assessed a regional AOP on the left lung, which was again 3. But unfortunately, if when he assessed the right lung, the AOP was very high, 17 centimeters of water. But again, if you assess globally the AOP, so you will underestimate some regional high AOP of the patient. So in conclusion, airway clotture is common and dynamic phenomena because you may have positive and after that negative, or it could be negative and after that positive. Parietal, extrinsic, and intraluminal factors may contribute to this airway clotture and is diagnosed using a low flow insufflation maneuver or the other technique with the conductive pressure, which may use a normal flow, inspiratory flow, and AOP measured by the ventilator, of course, as I demonstrated to you, underestimates the highest regional AOP. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Michel. This was an excellent presentation, but Professor Gattinoni told us never take something for granted. So I'm sure there's questions or comments from the audience. So maybe I can start. You already explained a little bit, but I have some difficulty in understanding when I do my assessment of airway opening pressure that the ventilator more or less gives a single number. And as a pulmonologist, if I look at the lung, I would think there would be 100, or at least if it's at the segmental bronchi level, 5 or 6 AOPs. So why, if you do this slow inflation, you only find one AOP and not multiple AOPs?
Yes.
What are we looking at?
Honestly, I don't know. I'm sure that the physiologist in the room will be able to explain that. But I think that at least in the patients that we did in our unit, we demonstrated that only a very small part of the lung had a very high AOP. And really, I don't know why we get this low AOP, which represent, in fact, the lowest AOP and not the highest AOP. So I agree with you that it's very, very strange. I'm sure that maybe Laurent or somebody else may explain that.
You want to comment?
I wonder if it's pendulift. What do you think?
Well, one thing is that we don't know the location, but I suspect that in many patients in the ICU, when we have this large, you know, complete closure and then opening, it's a central phenomenon. And because if you explore patients who have known tracheal bronchial malacia, it's exactly the same presentation. Yeah. So I think when we see this major change, it's a central phenomenon. Yeah. And indeed, just to add that, we have tried in some patients the sandbags, you know, on the chest. Mm. And we realized it creates a major AOP. So confirming that it's probably a central phenomenon in many patients, not in all, but so it does not address your question, but I think this is what we see first.
Yeah. Well, if it's really a central problem, it should address the question, right? But yeah. if it's that central, you would expect that we can visualize it with fiber optic bronchoscopy, or?
Yeah. Yeah. It was seen on the bronchoscopy.
Right.
But as well, as we demonstrated, it happens in a small bronchi as well. So that's why I agree with Laurent. Maybe there are many different phenomena. It's not only one entity. I think it's maybe something which is mixing phenomena.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid we have to move on. It's a pleasure and honor to introduce the next speaker, Professor Laurent Bouchard from Toronto, Canada, and he's going to discuss using EIT.
Thank you very much, Leo and Jeremy. I was thinking that if people do not understand what is recruitability, they could look at this room. Look at that. This is typical of a non-recruitable room, which means you put more pressure, you have more people entering the room, but no more seats. Okay? Maybe you could think this is a little bit of recruitability, but... So our laboratory is working with a number of companies to get research grants and equipment. We have been working with Dräger, for instance. So recently we wrote this review article to describe why, unfortunately, compliance, the best compliance, which is often used to select the best PEEP, is not working very well. There are many reasons, and maybe if you want one, look at the ART trial, which was shown by Luciano, which showed higher mortality in the group where PEEP was titrated very high to try to reduce the driving pressure. So what to do at the bedside? And one approach we could propose is first to ask the question, are the lungs of the patients recruitable? Yes or no? And if they are recruitable, can we find something close to an optimal PEEP or an optimal compromise? And maybe the EIT could be the answer. So as discussed, for recruitability, that's not easy. That's why we designed a technique called the recruitment to inflation ratio, which has the advantage of being feasible at the bedside on any ventilator with minimal precautions, and which will tell you whether your lung is more on the non-recruitable side, like in this room. So don't try to put more. You can always put more volume with more pressure, but that will not reopen the lung. Or the lung is more on the recruitable side, and then it's worth to try to see if more PEEP could be beneficial. So that's the technique. In one breath, you decrease abruptly the PEEP level from 15 to 5, and from the exhaled volume, you try to assess whether this is simply the baby lung which was over distended, like in this room, or there was more lung which has been recruited and which is de-recruited in this maneuver. So, and it has been validated more or less against a number of other physiological measurements, but also some measurements like the lung ultrasound, the EIT, and more recently the CT scan, even if it's not exactly the same thing. So once you know, so if your lung is not recruitable, don't try to increase PEEP. Keep the minimal PEEP, which is sufficient, maybe slightly lower than 10, so go to 8. And if the lung is recruitable, maybe it's worth to try to increase the PEEP. I'm not saying go for a high PEEP in everybody. And I have to say that the EIT technique is really very attractive to try to understand better what you do with when you increase PEEP in your patient. So EIT, there's a lot of technology behind that. It started to be described many years ago, like the change in impedance of the chest when you have more or less air. So what you see is in proportion to the amount of air, But the advantage is that you can do that regionally. So you have something which looks like a CT image, and you see where the volume is going. And because you can divide this area into pixels, for each pixel you can see whether the volume increase for a certain delta of pressure is done with more facility, which means lower, higher compliance, or with more difficulty, which would mean lower compliance. So what is usually done is a decremental PEEP titration. Why decremental? Because the EIT needs a reference value. And the reference value is the highest possible PEEP, tolerable for a few minutes. I will show you data where we went up to 24 for a few minutes, but in some patients we stopped at 16 or 18 because we didn't want to go higher. And you consider this reference, and then you see what is the effect of progressively decreasing PEEP. If for each pixel you see a drop in compliance, it means that this pixel is collapsing. That's how you interpret. If you see an improvement in compliance, it means that this pixel was over the standard. And after that, you can create from, again, here it's 25 to 7, the amount of distension progressively going down, and at the same time, the amount of collapse progressively going up. And you see you have a crossing point between the collapse curve and the distension curve. And we used this technique during the COVID pandemic, and Annemijn Jonkman from Amsterdam is the main author of this multi-center study where many centers participated and provided the data. And our first simple question was, can we do like the beautiful study of Luciano with a CT scan showing the variability in lung recruitability, can we do that with EIT at the bedside? And the answer is yes. You see the we express here the recruitability as a decrease in collapse from 6 to 24 of PEEP, and some patients have a 70% change in collapse. Some patients have only less than 10%. So you can describe how much recruitable is the lung. But in addition to that, we did this crossing point approach. And I'm just giving you two examples. This would be a low recruiter patient. So the blue is the hyperdistension. The red is the collapse. And you see this patient does not collapse very much, but is very, very hyperdistended. And so your crossing point would be very low, between 5 and 10. Indicating where you have this compromise between collapse and distension. And this would be an example of a highly recruitable patients where you see a huge change in collapse and the distension starting here. So in every individual patient now, we are not talking of average, you can do this curve and select where you want to set your PEEP. If you think that you don't know, and what we don't know is good to know sometimes, if you don't know whether it's more harmful to distend or more harmful to keep collapse, you can choose this compromise between collapse and distension. And I have to say we were really impressed by this result. This is just a way to present the data where you have the group of patients with low recruitability, medium recruitability, high recruitability. It's just a way to show the results. And you see the PEEP level selected, of course, would be lower in that group, around 8 to 10, a bit more in that group, or around 12 to 14, and 14 to 16 in the high recruitability group. But whichever the group, for every individual patient, you always have the guarantee that you are like between, you have lower than 10% of collapse and lower than 10% of distension. So really exciting technique to potentially individualize the data. This is a comparison with compliance. You see, sometimes it's close, sometimes it's higher, sometimes it's lower. It's not the same PEEP level. The next question, of course, is it better for the patient to keep the PEEP at this crossing point? Or is it better to minimize the distension or to minimize the collapse? We don't know. So we did a randomized study in pigs. Very useful to have animals to do this preliminary study, where we compare the three PEEP settings, crossing point, and this is the individual values. It was randomized, the pigs were randomized into three groups. Low collapse, which means high PEEP, or low over distension. And maybe you can guess what's the result. Well, we were surprised. Because the main first result is that the group with low PEEP, so minimizing distension, this is a very recruitable model of lung injury, did very, very poorly. Half of the animals died very quickly, and they died of right ventricular failure. And when we look at the data of compliance or shunt or all physiological variables for the survivors, it was always worse. In our study, it was difficult to find the difference between the crossing point and the high PEEP group, except on some histological data, which suggested that maybe the lung was more homogeneous with the crossing point and was a bit less inflamed with less protein, but that was relatively subtle differences. So to conclude, there is no unique optimal PEEP for all regions of the lung. Knowing the overall recruitability is the first important step. Insufficient PEEP can have serious negative consequences on the right ventricle in recruitable lungs. And EIT may offer an optimal compromise for PEEP titration. Thank you very much.
We have time for a couple questions, if anybody has one. Maybe I'll start, Laurent, if you don't mind. You touched on this just a little bit at the end, and I'm so glad you did. But I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about whether we should even care about whether the lung is recruitable. Because I think, you know, so much of how I think about ventilation-induced lung injury is around stress and strain on the lung. And it's not clear to me how recruitability directly ties into that. And I worry sometimes that, you know, as this session sort of nicely illustrates, when you talk about lung mechanics and you break it down into, okay, today we're going to talk about PEEP, tomorrow we're going to talk about tidal volume, et cetera, it sort of misses the point, which is that you have to integrate both where the breath starts and where the breath stops to understand lung injury. And so I think I struggle with whether recruitability then is the right focus. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
So two points to address. So first one, the question is there any benefit of having PEEP? So maybe first answer, without PEEP, the patients would die. So you need PEEP, okay? Do you need up above a certain minimal level, which maintain oxygenation in, so is there any benefit of PEEP? And this is the question of this room. Are you going to just distend what is already present, or is there any benefit on recruiting more space, which was below the opening pressure and which was left collapsed? And that makes a huge difference in your reasoning about stress and strain. Because if you put the same tidal volume in the small lung versus a more open lung, which is kept open by PEEP, it makes a huge difference. So I do think it's important, and the second aspect is that what we really learned from that study is that so it's not only the lung, it's also the circulation, which makes a big difference. You know, this classical U-shaped curve of pulmonary vascular resistance versus lung volume, which were at the FRC, you are in the best position. We don't know how to apply that in a lung injury model, right? Because we are far below the normal FRC. So is that what we are doing when we are putting PEEP? We are replacing close to FRC for the best circulation? I think it is the case, but we need to prove it. And this is an indirect argument to say probably this is the case, because at low PEEP in this, again, recruitable severe lung injury model, the circulation was much worse.
So can I ask a follow-up question? So do you agree when we use EIT that we should always take the hemodynamics into consideration? And if so, what would be your recommendation? Would you look at central venous oxygen saturation and different levels of PEEP? Or, I mean, we're talking that this is all important, but how do we incorporate that in our clinical reasoning?
You know, a number of people use the esophageal pressure to titrate the PEEP, which makes sense. And for instance, in obese patients, you find very high level of intrathoracic pressure. And I say, that's very useful to know because in this obese patient, I know the esophageal pressure, the intrathoracic pressure. So I raise the PEEP at that level because this is already the pressure in the thorax and I want to counteract the effect of the chest wall. I'm saying that because the huge difference between a patient who have this high level of intrathoracic pressure or a low level like many is the hemodynamic tolerance. It's very well tolerated because the pressure was already high in the thorax. So I think the circulation and looking at the circulation at the same time is extremely important. We could not do one without the other.
Any other questions? Great. I guess a moment. Thank you so much, Laurent, for that great talk. So my pleasure to introduce next Dr. Ewan Gallagher, also from Toronto, who's going to be talking about PEEP titration according to driving pressure. Thanks so much for joining us, Ewan.
Thank you, Dr. Beitler. Thank you to everyone in the audience for joining us this afternoon. Unfortunately, those who wrote the program made a mistake in having me come after Dr. Brochard because he's my boss and he just said I'm wrong. So I guess you'll have to take everything I say here with a grain of salt.
He left. It's okay.
Oh, perfect. Okay. Now, don't tell him about anything I'm about to say. All right. So this is an interesting session. And PEEP, of course, is a perennial challenge. And I'm not sure that any of us has absolutely the right answer quite yet. Ask Dr. Beitler in 5 years. He'll come back and tell you. But in the meantime, I want to take a stab by suggesting that one very promising and rational way to manage PEEP at the bedside is to target the driving pressure. All right, these are my disclosures, none of which are especially relevant to this presentation. I am the PI, or global co-PI on a randomized clinical trial of driving pressure, which we'll mention at the end, funded by CIHR. All right, so one of the things that makes PEEP terrifically complicated is that it does a million things. And so I find it helpful to focus in on the one thing that actually really matters, which is actually a point that's already been raised for discussion here. What should we really be after to limit lung injury when we're applying PEEP? And I want to suggest that the real issue is tidal stress and strain. And what does that have to do with PEEP? Well, one of the things that perhaps potentially sidetracked our field a little bit was a ton of focus on opening and closing, cyclic opening and closing, the so-called atelic trauma hypothesis. And while it's very difficult for me to say that atelic trauma doesn't matter at all, the available data, and it would take some time to wade through all this literature, suggests that, in fact, much of the injury that's a consequence of atelectasis occurs in the baby lung, not in the regions that are collapsed and not in the regions that are cyclically opening and closing. And this was demonstrated in what I think is a classic paper by Brett and Kavanaugh and colleagues, where they induced lung injury and compared the magnitude of lung injury after lung lavage in the dependent and non-dependent lung regions. So they have another figure in this paper showing, first of all, that in the dependent lung region, there was much greater alveolar collapse and atelectasis. And then when they sacrificed the animals to look at lung injury score and hyaline membrane score, you can see that the magnitude of injury is far greater in the non-dependent lung region where there's no atelectasis. And so The interesting thing here is that atelectasis, the induction of atelectasis, seems to predispose the baby lung to lung injury. And that of course, is our basic baby lung model of how ventilator-induced lung injury happens. So why is it that atelectasis is harmful? Well, the problem with atelectasis is that by reducing the number of lung units participating in ventilation, you effectively redistribute that ventilation to fewer alveoli, and therefore you have greater stress and strain per alveolus or lung unit. And this interesting paper here that, again, in collaboration with Maurizio Serreta and Brian Kavanaugh, they measured that the lung acinar size in a healthy lung, shown here with the triangle, and in two different lung injury models, shown in the squares and the circles. And the y-axis here is the apparent diffusion coefficient, which is basically a way of measuring lung unit size. And what you can see is that as you're increasing PEEP, well, in the healthy lung, as you'd expect, increasing the PEEP increases the lung unit size. You're progressively inflating the lung. That's what you'd expect. But interestingly, as you progressively increase PEEP in these recruitable models of lung injury, you see a progressive decrease in lung unit size. So what the PEEP is doing is increasing the number of lung units available for ventilation such that now the inflation per unit actually decreases. And that's the critical benefit of PEEP that we're after. So it's kind of simple way of envisioning this effect of PEEP on the lung, and the way that it affects lung stress and strain during tidal ventilation is to imagine this model here where you take a single lung unit, you apply a PEEP of 10, go from FRC to a PEEP of 10, so you have a new end expiratory lung volume, and then you apply a given tidal volume on top of that, and that tidal volume is applied to that one lung unit, so you have a strain ratio of approximately 1/3. But now if by increasing the PEEP, I go from one lung unit to two lung units and apply the same tidal volume, well, that tidal volume is now divided between those two units such that the strain per unit is decreased. And so the lung stress is decreased. That's the holy grail from a lung protection point of view anyways that we want to achieve with PEEP. Oh dear, I hate it when this happens. But so this figure here comes from an analysis that we did of the higher versus lower tidal volume trials, looking at how baseline elastance modifies the effect of being randomized from higher tidal volume to lower tidal volume. So the y-axis here is the probability of death. The x-axis here is the normalized elastance. It's the elastance normalized to predicted body weight. And then the blue curve represents patients randomized to higher tidal volume, and the red curve represents the patients randomized to lower tidal volume. And what's of note is that there was a large variation in the mortality difference between the randomized groups at low elastance. There's really very little difference in mortality between lower versus higher tidal volume. Whereas at higher elastance, there's significant separation with a decrease in mortality with lower tidal volume. Now, take a patient, for example, whose elastance is 1.5 and compare that with a patient whose elastance is 3. And you can see really that in the latter case, the latter patient with a higher elastance is much more likely to sustain a mortality harm from applying higher tidal volume. And what is one of the major reasons why we have increases in elastance during mechanical ventilation for ARDS? Well, it's atelectasis and loss of lung volume resulting in a smaller baby lung. That's just what a high elastance in ARDS means. So effectively what you can imagine here is that this atelectasis is shifting the patient from a no harm situation to a situation now where increasing the tidal volume may have a substantial impact on the patient's risk of death. And so atelectasis bad, getting rid of atelectasis good. The big question then is, how do we do that? Well, so what I want to suggest is that monitoring the mechanics, the compliance and the driving pressure, although not perfect, gives us a way to see to what extent increasing or changing the PEEP is ameliorating this problem of atelectasis, reducing the lung volume. And this, you know, there's like a million studies that have documented this, these physiological responses to different PEEPs. So for example, a paper by Grasso and colleagues that's now over 2 decades old, compared PEEP responders and non-responders. You can see that the non-responders had very little change in the volume of recruited lung after applying a recruitment maneuver, whereas the responders had a very large increase in the volume of recruited lung. So this is really what we're trying to do here with PEEP. We're trying to increase the volume of recruited lung and decrease the volume of atelectasis. And what you can see here is that in the non-responders, there's really no change in elastance, and there's a very large decrease in elastance in response to recruitment in the responders. And that correlates with the gas exchange response. So these simple bedside measures reflecting what the PEEP is doing to the lung in terms of mechanics. And this idea of titrating your PEEP to optimize your compliance and your driving pressure is really not new at all. This dates all the way back to Peter Suter's paper in the New England Journal in 1975. And what was so impressive in that paper is that the PEEP level that optimized compliance was also the PEEP level that optimized oxygen transport, that achieved a significant reduction in shunt and improvements in hypoxemia. And so there's a lot going on in the lung, of course. We're concerned about the hemodynamics as well as we are about the alveolar mechanics. And if you're optimizing PEEP to optimize compliance, well, that may well give you a relatively safe effect in terms of hemodynamics as well. So there's really, this is not a new idea. All right, so theoretically compelling, some plausible rationale for why we would target the PEEP based on minimizing the tidal stress and strain. What evidence might we cite in support of this approach? The first thing I would say, because I didn't actually include a slide on the ART trial here, which might seem like a bit of an oversight, but I confess that because of the really aggressive recruitment strategy employed in that trial, and because of the fact that a recent network meta-analysis suggests that recruitment maneuvers per se seem to be an important cause of harm, that I kind of find it impossible to know how much ART really contributes to this conversation around how to actually titrate the PEEP level and whether it's ruled out benefit from a driving pressure-driven strategy. So with that said, I'll skip over this because it's basically the reverse of what I already suggested. A couple of years ago, Nadir Yahya and colleagues published this interesting reanalysis of the alveoli trial. And in this paper, they looked at the relationship between the risk, the hazard of death, or time to mortality, and the change and the initial change in driving pressure after randomization to a higher or lower PEEP strategy in the alveoli trial. And the curves here, the colors of the curves here represent patients randomized to higher versus lower PEEP. They have the same shape, so which group is which is not important. But what you can see is, interestingly, the initial change in the driving pressure after randomization is correlated in both patients randomized to higher PEEP and lower PEEP to a lower risk of death. And the greater the reduction in driving pressure in this period immediately following randomization, the progressively greater reduction in the risk of death. So this is not causal evidence, but it's a really impressive and intriguing association suggesting that if the changes that you make on the ventilator result in a lower driving pressure after being randomized to a higher or lower PEEP strategy, well, that's likely going, maybe what may well be associated with an improved outcome for the patient. I would also point you to Marcelo Amato's legendary mediation analysis of driving pressure published in the New England Journal now nearly 10 years ago, where they showed that the benefit of a higher PEEP strategy on mortality was largely mediated by the effect of the different PEEP strategies on the driving pressure. So the figure at the top shows this relationship between being randomized to higher PEEP and survival. And then the figure below shows the fact that this randomization, this association is lost once you account for the intervening effects of driving pressure. So all of the benefit of being randomized to a higher PEEP strategy is mediated through a reduction in driving pressure. So again, this provides us with what I would call circumstantial evidence in favor of this report. Saria Sahatia, an investigator at Johns Hopkins in the US, has had a research program studying specific driving pressure based PEEP titration strategy. And her work today has shown that this is feasible and often results, often PEEP titration can result in some reduction in driving pressure in some patients. Not always. Some patients are already at their optimal compliance, but in many patients, you obtain a reduction in driving pressure. So the approach seems to be feasible and well tolerated. Now, there is an important caveat, and it's a bit complicated, but I think this is the same. I would sort of be at pains to point out that with a rigorous and very sophisticated technique like electrical impedance tomography, where we're comparing the PEEP set to minimize collapse and hyperdistension versus the PEEP that optimizes compliance, Dr. Bouchard already pointed out that you don't always get exactly the same PEEP from the two strategies. And this has to do with this issue of what tidal recruitment, where the lung actually recruits during the delivery of the tidal insufflation. And when that happens, it makes the compliance look falsely good, because lung units that go from closed to open during a tidal breath have an effective compliance of infinity. So it biases your estimate of compliance. And one of the ways that you see that is the way in which the compliance curve during a PEEP titration depends on the applied tidal volume. So the higher the tidal volume, the lower the apparent optimal PEEP on this plot. So here you've got compliance measurements over a decremental PEEP trial. And what you can see is that the optimal PEEP, where the compliance is maximized, depends on the magnitude of the tidal volume being applied. So that's a bit consternating, because it means that if you're titrating to optimize driving pressure and compliance, well, you'll get different values depending on what tidal volume you're setting. And so I think probably some work needs to be done still to standardize the approach. But if, for example, you're committed to the dogma of using a tidal volume of 6 mL/kg per the clinical practice guidelines, then you would at least have a constant effect while maintaining a constant tidal volume. So there are some limitations that should and source of noise in this approach that should be appreciated. So to summarize, in over just a few minutes, I've tried to press the case that tidal stress is what we're really after when we're titrating PEEP, that the mechanics, the compliance, the driving pressure give us imperfect but still truly valuable insights about tidal stress, that driving pressure may well be a marker of favorable response to PEEP, but we still need definitive RCT evidence to prove that this really is the optimal, doing things this way will improve outcomes for the patient. And I just want to draw your attention to this global clinical trial, the DRIVE RCT, which is running on the Practical platform. It's over 100 sites around the world. Many of you in the room are collaborators on this trial, where we hope to answer this question of whether driving pressure targeted ventilation is superior to conventional tidal volume limited lung protective ventilation. And a critical part of that intervention when the driving pressure is high is to adjust the PEEP in order to try and optimize compliance. So we're still many years away from having a result here, but excited to be doing this with you nevertheless. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ewan, for this excellent presentation. Maybe I can ask the audience, who's actually using the optimal driving pressure, the lowest driving pressure to titrate PEEP? Not as many as I would have expected. So maybe, Ewan, can you give us some practical recommendations? How would you do this in clinical practice? And my main issue is, with increasing PEEP, there's the slow and the rapid responders. For some patients, it takes time to recruit with higher levels of PEEP, right? So how does it look like? What would you advise the audience to find the optimal PEEP based on the driving pressure?
Sure. So in my old age, I've gotten very practical. And by that I mean is that I keep it really simple. So if you're setting the tidal volume and the respiratory rate to maintain an adequate minute ventilation, having done so, measure the plateau pressure and the PEEP to measure the driving pressure. And if the driving pressure is over 15, then in our trial, what we would be doing is suggesting titration of PEEP. Try turning it up a few centimeters of water. And if that has no effect over a couple of minutes, then try turning it down to see if that will improve the compliance. Because if it's always unpredictable exactly where the patient is on their pressure volume curve. Now, you're right. There is a period of, there's kind of an initial mechanical response sometimes, but sometimes it takes 10 to 15 minutes for the lung to settle. But 10-minute period is typically what's needed for mechanical stabilization. So, you know, we reassess the patient every 3 to 4 hours as part of routine practice. And the thing I've learned is not to require people to do it much more often than that, just because it's not feasible otherwise. But really what we're talking about are small changes made on a regular basis to try and continuously optimize the ventilation conditions.
Okay, and maybe another question. Oh, sorry. Can you please have a microphone right here? Yeah, that's one coming up.
I'm not sure Luciano needs a microphone. I'll repeat the question.
How do you play with the plateau and with the plateau? You might decrease the diving pressure
and having maybe the plateau going up. Put in extreme situation, you know?
Yeah.
And, yeah. And no one word about the hemodynamics. And tell me what is the difference between a Suter and compliance approach. I mean, what you look is just that one. You have the same tidal volume, you measure the driving pressure equal to measure the compliance. That's it.
Yeah.
It's not very new. So I'm ready to beat with you about the results of the study.
Okay, I'll look forward to that. I mean, I'd be disappointed otherwise. I guess with respect to this question of whether we should also be concerned about the plateau when you're turning up the PEEP in order to reduce the driving pressure, clearly we don't want to push the plateau too excessively. But actually, I would say it was your work that persuaded me that the dynamic swings in pressure are probably much more important than the peak global strain as reflected by the plateau pressure. So you're welcome to dissuade me, but I actually felt like among a lot of literature that it was your work that really signaled that we need to attend to the dynamic swings in pressure as opposed to the peak value of strain per se.
Well, I think this is an important point because one thing is a tidal stress that you have, and another thing is a total stress. I mean, the total stress may have to do with the physics of the lung. If I start with 20 of PEEP, as an example, no? And I add some maybe driving pressure of 10 or 15 or so, I really risk to reach the total lung compliance. And this is a disaster because all the literature, the experimental literature, is full of example of this. So I think there is an intrinsic problem to look only to the driving pressure. You have to always to look also to the tidal volume and to the frequency. I think we cannot isolate this part. The same driving pressure, starting with 5 of people, 20 of people, have a completely different in terms of stress, final stress. And the body reaction. This, at least in the German pigs, is extremely clear.
Mm. Yeah, it's not good for German pigs. So the point I think is being made is that none of all of these components, the driving pressure, the plateau pressure, the tidal volume, the respiratory, we're all tightly interdependent, and we obviously all need to look at all of them and not just focus on one in particular. I would think that if you're pushing your PEEP very high and you're transgressing these plateau pressure limits, that you're also going to start to see increases in driving pressure and decreases in compliance as you reach the limit of, you know, what the lung can tolerate in terms of total stress. So they should, in general, go hand in hand. I think the one scenario where you see perhaps something of an unusual situation would be the patient with severe obesity, where the pressure volume of the curve of the chest wall is shifted to the right, and you have much higher airway pressures that don't necessarily entail increases in tidal stress. So I think that's the one situation where I think driving pressure would still play out in a sensible way.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I'm afraid we have to move on. And it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Lise Piquillot from Lausanne, Switzerland, and she will discuss the role of the esophageal balloon in setting PEEP. Please, Lise.
Good afternoon, everybody. Very happy to be here to discuss quite a complex topic again about PEEP setting. These are my disclosures, but nothing is related to this presentation. All of us use higher PEEP in ARDS patients. Why? Because we think that by applying higher pressure, we can recruit some part of the lung. In other words, we can open lung units that are closed at the end of expiration. And this is well illustrated in the bottom part of this slide that shows CT scans of a patient who can be recruited by applying here higher end inspiratory pressures. But we also know, as nicely demonstrated by Luciano Gattinoni some years ago, that recruitability is not the same in all our ARDS patients. And we nicely see here that in some patients, we cannot recruit anything. In other patients, we can recruit a small proportion of the lung tissue. And in some not so frequent patients, we can really recruit a lot by applying higher pressure. But nevertheless, what we can say is that ARDS is at least to some extent a recruitable lung. But we need to individualize, and we need to find a tool to individualize our settings, especially PEEP setting. Then what are we doing when we increase PEEP? Let's start from a very simplified model, a monocompartmental model illustrated here. In such a model, the compliance, which basically represents the distensibility of the system, can be computed as a change in volume divided by the corresponding difference in the transmural pressure. And here, in gray, you have what I call here the end expiratory volume with the initial PEEP you've set. Now, if you increase the level of PEEP, in this monocompartmental model, you are going to increase the end expiratory volume. This is directly related to the delta PEEP you've applied. And this increase in volume can be easily computed by playing a bit with the compliance formula, and the volume that is increased just by increasing the PEEP equals the compliance of the lung times the difference in the transmural pressure of the lung you've measured with the two different levels of PEEP. But the lung is not a monocompartmental model. We have a lot of alveolar units with a lot of different potential for recruitment. It's a very inhomogeneous structure, the lung. And basically, when you increase PEEP, you more have that. You have alveoli that cannot be recruited at all. They stay closed. They are gray in the right part of the image. You have alveoli that can be opened. They are blue in this image. And you have some alveoli that were already opened with the initial level of PEEP that are going to be over-distended when you apply more pressure. Then the idea is that to find the best PEEP for a given patient at a given time, you need to find PEEP that is high enough to recruit at least some alveolar units in order to decrease atelectasis, to prevent atelect trauma, to improve ventilation perfusion matching, and to improve oxygenation. But in the same time, your right amount of PEEP has to be low enough to avoid at least too much overdistension, because overdistension is also not good. This is going to increase intrathoracic pressure. This is going to lead to some hemodynamic compromise. And this is also going to reduce the lymphatic drainage, which is a problem when you already have edema in the lung parenchyma. In other words, we can say that the best PEEP is the one that can recruit the alveoli, that can be recruited safely without too many adverse effects. Another way to say the same thing, but now looking at the transmural pressure of the lung, is to say that the PEEP has to be high enough to limit the atelectasis at the end of expiration, which means high enough to keep the pressure in the alveoli higher than the pressure around the lung to avoid collapse. And in the same time, the PEEP should be low enough to limit the maximal distending pressure at the end of inspiration. But how can I do that in practice? The only way to do that is to find a way to measure the transmural pressure of the lung, both at end expiration and at end inspiration. Let's come back to my very simple model. Again, we have the respiratory system with the lungs and the chest wall. The transmural pressure of the respiratory system is the difference between the pressure in the alveoli and the pressure around the patient, which is the atmospheric pressure. And this transmural pressure of the respiratory system has two components. First, the transmural pressure of the lung, that is illustrated here by the blue arrow, and the transmural pressure of the chest wall, which is illustrated here by the green arrow. What I need to measure if I want to individualize my PEEP setting in order to both avoid collapse at the end of expiration and overdistension at the end of inspiration is the transmural pressure of the lung, or the transpulmonary pressure, which equals the pressure inside the airway and the alveoli minus the pressure in the pleura. And to do that, I need to measure pleural pressure. And this can be done by using a balloon that can be put in the distal part of the esophagus. Basically, for anatomical reasons, because this part of the esophagus is very close to the pleural space. Then I can measure the pleural pressure, and if I can measure the pleural pressure, I can measure the transmural pressure of the lung, and I can set my ventilator to keep targets of transmural pressure of the lung, both at the end of expiration and at the end of expiration. Now, with my pleural pressure measurement, how can I compute this transmural pressure of the lungs? And here, it becomes a bit more complicated, because there are different ways to do. First, the easy one. You just take the pressure in the alveoli during a hold, during an occlusion, and you subtract the pleural pressure. This is the direct measurement. This can be done for end expiration during an end expiratory hold, and this can be held at end inspiration during an end inspiratory hold. Direct measurement, easy to understand. But there are some arguments that say that sometimes the absolute value of pleural pressure is not very reliable. For example, because there is some weight of the mediastinum structure that are pushing on the esophagus. And based on that, there was another way that was described to assess the lung transmural pressure. This strategy is based on the idea that, as said before, the total distending pressure of the respiratory system equals the sum of the distending pressure of the lung, basically the pressure that is needed to expand the lung, and the distending pressure of the chest wall, which is the pressure that is needed to expand the chest wall. Then, playing a bit by the formula, you find this way to compute the transmural pressure of the lung, or transpulmonary pressure. Transpulmonary pressure at the end of inspiration equals plateau pressure measured with the ventilator times the elastance of the lung divided by the elastance of the respiratory system. Then we have two ways to measure transpulmonary pressure of the lung. And this is very interesting because these two ways of doing do not represent the same thing in real life. First of all, easy to understand, at the end of expiration, we can say, based on animal studies done in pigs and on studies done with human cadaver, that the direct measurement, just the total PEEP minus the pleural pressure during an expiratory hold, is a good approximation of what can be measured directly using sensors placed in the pleura. Then that means that for end expiration, you can just use the direct measurement. For end inspiration, it's a bit different. Because, as illustrated here, again in an animal model and in the model with human cadaver, you can see that the direct measurements mainly represent the situation of pleural pressure and transpulmonary pressure in the dependent region of the lungs, basically the posterior part of the lung. And the elastance-based measured value, better represent the situation in the upper part of the lungs, which are the non-dependent part of the lungs. And that means that when you use pleural pressure and transpulmonary pressure to set PEEP, you need to think at what you are using. Then how can we do practically? First thing, you can set your PEEP in order to target an end expiratory transpulmonary pressure of more than zero. Easy to do, easy to understand. This means that you don't have a lot of alveolar collapse, at least as a general point of view, because you cannot measure this way each alveolar unit, of course. And then, as a second step, you can look at the end inspiratory transpulmonary pressure of the lung, and you can adapt your ventilator settings, PEEP and or tidal volume, to keep this end inspiratory distending pressure in safe values. Those safe values remain matter of debate. We don't have enough data to give you targets or absolute targets. But based on physiology, we can consider that we can target an end inspiratory transpulmonary pressure with the direct measurement lower than 15 centimeters of water. This basically reflects what is in the dependent lung regions. And we can target an end inspiratory transpulmonary pressure measured with the elastance-derived method lower than 20. What about the literature we have doing this way? The physiological rationale is, at least in my opinion, very strong to use this strategy to individualize the ventilator settings. And based on evidence-based medicine, we have EpiVent 1, EpiVent 2, a reanalysis of EpiVent 2, and I'm sure we are going to have new studies in the future. First, EpiVent 1, the first randomized study on the topic, an intervention group with PEEP set according to pleural pressure and transpulmonary pressure, and a control group based on PEEP FiO2 table. This study was stopped early than initially predicted because of the huge improvement in oxygenation in the PEEP-based strategy. There was also better compliance in this group, And there was a trend toward better outcome in the esophageal pressure-based strategy for setting the ventilator. And then we had EpiVent 2, which is bigger, with another outcome. The primary endpoint was a ranked composite outcome with the idea of assessing whether the patient had or not a more favorable outcome. And this study is negative. No impact on mortality and also not on this combined primary endpoint. But there are a lot of things to say about this study. There was a very wide range of target pressure, especially for end expiratory transpulmonary pressure. And there are also a huge variety of different patients included in this study. There was a reanalysis of those data that has been published quite recently. And very interestingly, we can see, as illustrated here in the slide, that if we target an end expiratory transpulmonary pressure between minus 2 and plus 2, very close to zero, we have an impact, a positive impact on mortality compared to a standard strategy. We also have new data in ECMO patients. We can discuss about the quality of this study, but basically in this study, using the esophageal pressure-based strategy leads to higher PEEP, lower tidal volume, lower driving pressure, and more ECMO weaning. New data, new thing, and the place for new randomized trials. Then in summary, properly setting PEEP means limiting atelectasis while avoiding overdistension. This requires individualization because not all our patients with ARDS are the same. We can measure transpulmonary pressure just by placing an esophageal balloon in the distal part of the esophagus. We can use the 2 or 3 step strategy I showed you. First, set PEEP to target end expiratory transpulmonary pressure between 0 and 2, then check the transpulmonary inspiratory and inspiratory transpulmonary pressure of the lung to limit overdistension. Definitely, I think that there is a strong physiological rationale for doing so, and we need further studies. Thanks for your attention.
Right, it's a fantastic talk, Lisa. I think you gave the answer, as people are now satisfied. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, you touched briefly on utilizing transponder pressure also to guide tidal volume. And one of the things I was struck by is your recommendation of inspiratory transponder pressure of around 15 seems to align relatively well, I think, with the airway driving pressure of about 15. I was wondering if you could talk about that and if you think they're telling the same story or they might actually be different numbers.
The number is the same, but the meaning is probably not exactly the same because the driving pressure definitely reflects the whole respiratory system. Using the strategy I showed you, you can better assess the lungs. However, in a lot of patients, there is not a bad correlation between respiratory system compliance and lung compliance. But in other patients, the difference or the correlation can be very poor. Then if we have complicated patients, the one for which you don't know how to set PEEP, I think you need to look at the lung and not at the respiratory system in general.
Fantastic, thank you. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate it. Great talk. It's my pleasure to introduce next Dr. Antoine Vieux-Baron, who I think is the foremost expert on acute coronary pulmonale and ARDS, and pleased to hear him present today about PEEP optimization and not forgetting the RV.
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. So that's really fascinating because we discussed a lot of points during the beginning of this session, and I was thinking, finally, just looking at the RV, it's a good summary of all of the discussion, and I will try to explain why. Just let me start by some physiological rationale why we apply a PEEP. First, and this is something very frequently forgotten, this is for an hemodynamic reason. Let's take, for instance, an intravascular pressure in a small pulmonary artery of 15 millimeters of mercury, so on the right, in a spontaneously breathing patient, so doing a depression, so a negative thoracic pressure, negative pleural pressure, minus 10. So you have them fluid targeting transvascular pressure, which is really bad for the lung and so for pulmonary edema. Let's now applying with the same pressure into the vessel, a PEEP of 10, so or inducing an intrathoracic pressure of 10 millimeters of mercury, and you know now that you have a very low fluid targeting pressure, which is much better for the lung. So you protect the lung just by applying this PEEP, and if you protect the lung, probably that you protect also the pulmonary circulation. The second reason, of course, and it was discussed a lot during the previous talks, is that you have a huge heterogeneity of aeration of lung in ARDS patient. It was very nicely and a little bit complicated reported in this paper. I don't want to speak about Pendeluf or reverse Pendeluf effect, but it's just the fact that you have a well aerated or poorly aerated area in the lung, and when you do a pause at inexpiratory or expiration, you have some redistribution of gas from one unit to other units. And this is exactly what you see. This is due, and it was also discussed probably, by some collapse of the small bronchia at the end of expiration. And here, this is expiratory flow at low flow, less than 1 liter per second, much lower. And you see that at the end of expiration, you have an abrupt drop of the expiration, of the expiratory flow in this patient with ARDS ventilated in ZIP. And all of these patients, actually, they had a lower inflection point on the inspiratory PV curve. Let's now see that when you apply a PEEP of 6, just avoiding this collapse at the end of inspiration, you have a completely disappearance of this phenomenon, and now you have the PV loop, the inspiratory PV loop, which is linear, and so you do not recruit, you just avoid the de-recruitment during the expiration phase. And this is exactly what was observed here. During the inflation phase, if you inflate a total volume of 6 milliliters per kilogram, by definition, you always reach the opening pressure, so you recruit during the inspiration. What you want to do, applying the PEEP, is to avoid the de-recruitment, and look at now the closing pressure is much lower here than 10 millimeters of mercury, centimeters of water, sorry. Unfortunately, when we apply a PEEP, of course, we have on one side, and we know that, some recruitment, or we avoid the de-recruitment, so we have less hyperdense areas if you look at the CT scan. But in the same time, unfortunately, you overinflate some already aerated areas, especially in the non-dependent region of the lung, so the anterior part of the lung. And this is the key point. I think that Laurent spoke about that when he has a question about the relationship between the pulmonary vascular resistance, so the right ventricular afterload, and the transpulmonary pressure. Look at when you are too much on the left, so the lung is too much deaerated, you have an increased RV afterload and probably a poor RV function. On the opposite, when you are too much on the right, you overinflate the lung, and you need to know that ARDS is a very good model of competition between distending pressure of the alveoli and pulmonary capillaries. And in this case, you could collapse partially or completely the pulmonary capillaries, inducing pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Look at here, this is an experimental study, not in ARDS, in normal lung, just to show you that using invasive hemodynamic monitoring, just focus on the transmural pulmonary right atrial pressure, which is a surrogate of the amount of blood you have into the right atrium. Look at during a PEEP trial, until 10 centimeters of water, nothing really happens. At 10, you observed a significant increase in this distending pressure of the right atrium, so probably some obstruction occurring, and so more blood into the right cavities. So the concept, or I think what I do, is that just to look at the right ventricle to try to understand what is the balance between the overinflation and what I said, the recruitment, and once again, what I want to avoid is the de-recruitment. So don't forget the right ventricle to look at this balance. Do we have clinical or experimental studies to support this, this approach? Look at this very small one. So severe RDS patients ventilated with a protective mechanical ventilation. You have the relationship on the x-axis on the recruitment induced by the PEEP using the PV loop method at low flow. And you have here on the y-axis the decrease in the right ventricular stroke volume induced when we increased the PEEP from 7 to 14 centimeters of water. Look at, you have two different type of patients. These patients, they recruited a lot or they do not recruit at, de-recruited at all. And so in the same time, they tolerate very well the increase in PEEP with almost no change in the right ventricular stroke volume. We know that here it's not a model of ARDS, it's a model of atelectasis, a de-aeration of the lung. At baseline, you have a score of right ventricular function. And look at 2 hours after inducing the atelectasis, the de-aeration of the lung. Now you have right ventricular dilatation and right ventricular systolic impairment. And after re-aeration of the lung, you do not go back at the initial baseline, but you improve the right ventricular function. This is something that we see very well in obese patients with acute respiratory distress syndrome. Look at this patient. Initially, he was ventilated with a too low PEEP, 7 centimeters of water, and so we decided to increase the PEEP from 7 to 14. Look at the plateau pressure, initially significantly increased, but look at during the time, without any change on the tidal volume, we were able to observe the slight and progressive decrease in the plateau pressure, reflecting that we improved the respiratory mechanics and probably the lung aeration and compliance. Look at the RV. At PEEP 7, the RV was very significantly dilated compared to the LV. Look at PEEP 14, the right ventricle was much less dilated. So what was good here for the respiratory mechanics actually was very good for the right ventricular function and for the hemodynamics. We know also, and this is a very nice study, that when you ventilate normal lungs in rates, either with 45 of peak pressure without ZIP, you induce pulmonary edema, so ventilatory-induced pulmonary edema, and in the same time, this is the right picture, you induce right ventricular dysfunction, right ventricular impairment. When you apply a PEEP of 10 with the same peak pressure, you do not induce ventilatory-induced lung injury, and you do not have any effect on the right ventricular function. Probably by two mechanisms. The first one, as I told you, you decrease the filtering pressure of the small pulmonary arteries into the lung. And the second, of course, and it was discussed just very simply because they decreased the driving pressure, so it was much better tolerated for the lung and for the right ventricular function. But you have this kind of patients. They do not recruit at all or very minimally by doubling the PEEP. And so as a consequence, we observed a drop, a very big drop in the right ventricular stroke volume after applying the PEEP. Look at about a case, not doing echo in the past by doing the Swan-Ganz catheter. You have the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and the pulmonary artery pressure in an ARDS patient ventilated in ZIP, PEEP 0. You have here the transpulmonary pressure gradient, so very small, at least no precapillary pulmonary hypertension. Look at after applying a PEEP of 20, a huge increase in the transpulmonary pressure gradient. So now you induce precapillary pulmonary hypertension with consequence on the right ventricular function. And it was also nicely demonstrated in 1981 in the New England Journal of Medicine. You have a catheter into the RV, this is the Swan-Ganz catheter, and you have also a catheter into the LV, this is the higher pressure. Here in ZIP, you see a trend at end systole for an increase in the right ventricular pressure compared to the left ventricular pressure, but nothing very obvious. Look at with a PEEP of 12, you see now an inverted pressure gradient between both ventricles, which is completely abnormal, so you overload the right ventricle. And look at with a PEEP of 20, this is now obvious that you have a huge overloading of the right ventricle. Now if you use, for instance, the echo, here you have a small right ventricular overload, some dilatation, and a small paradoxical septal motion. Now increasing the PEEP, look at how the right ventricle is now dilated with a paradoxical septal motion. Still, using invasive hemodynamics and the Swan-Ganz catheter, look at in ARDS patient three different situations, ZIP, PEEP 10 centimeters of water, and PEEP 15 centimeters of water. Just concentrate at end expiration, so I don't speak about the effect on the inflation, just the effect of PEEP, on the pulmonary artery pressure pulse, the pulmonary artery pulse, sorry. The difference between the systolic pulmonary artery pressure and the diastolic pulmonary artery pressure, a surrogate of the AV stroke volume. Look at that PEEP 0, look at that PEEP 10, almost no change compared to PEEP 0, but look at now at PEEP 15, a huge drop in the pulmonary pulse, reflecting the fact that there is almost no blood which is ejected now by the right ventricle into the pulmonary circulation. It was already reported, so I do not want to comment about the Kaplan-Meier curve and the increased mortality in the high PEEP group, but with a very aggressive recruitment maneuver. I just want to add this data in the supplementary material, which is the need of commencement or increase of vasopressor or hypotension within 1 hour following the randomization between two groups, the low PEEP group and the very high PEEP group with an aggressive recruitment maneuver. Look at there was a very significant difference. Unfortunately, it was not planned, but we do not have any data about the right ventricular function, but it is probably very likely that in many of these patients, they observed right ventricular failure. So just to conclude and to keep my time, PEEP may be clearly beneficial in certain situations, especially to homogenize lung aeration and so protect the pulmonary circulation and the right heart. PEEP, especially when too high, even though I don't know exactly what does it mean, may adversely affect the right heart by inducing overinflation. But at the bedside, if you look at with your echo probe, you know when the PEEP is too high because now you have right ventricular failure. And finally, I am not completely convinced that this is a real discussion and maybe only a discussion of experts, because if you look at in the real life, the frontline physicians, they know very well the physiology. They know very well when they increase the PEEP what happens. And if you look at in the LungSafe, the mean PEEP apply was 8 centimeters of water. And even in the severe ARDS, it was 10 centimeters of water, which is really a reasonable PEEP level. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Antoine. This was really interesting. Are there any questions or comments from the audience? So maybe I can start, and it's a little bit different topic, but there was a paper very recently in the Blue Journal that investigated the effects of PEEP on coronary artery blood flow. So do you think this is something we need to take into consideration as well, or can you amend that
think,
a little bit?
Yeah, it's a good comment. I know this paper. I think what we know is that when you induce the right ventricular failure, this is probably because there is functional ischemia. And it is, of course, due to the dilatation, and so you increase the stress, the parietal stress of the RV, but the RV is especially sensitive to coronary perfusion because the RV is perfused during diastole as the LV, but also during systole. And so indeed, just looking at the flow into the coronary artery, for instance, that could decrease during when you increase the PEEP, it really could induce, with the combination of this increased stress, parietal stress, it could induce RV failure. So yes, definitively, I don't know if we can recommend to look at, because you need to be a little bit expert to visualize the right coronary artery and to monitor the flow at low PEEP and at high PEEP, but could be for the future something to do.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? If not, I think we can move on. Thank you very much again, Antoine. And it's a pleasure to introduce again Professor Michel Slaman from Amiens in France. And now he's going to talk about the left ventricle and PEEP.
Yes, after the right ventricle, the left ventricle. Thank you for this introduction. So, of course, I will show you exactly the same slide on this ART study, which demonstrated that I will show you later that when you want to recruit the collapsed tissue, of course, you have to do a recruitment maneuver and to set a high PEEP. But unfortunately, ART study demonstrated that it may increase the mortality. And as Antoine said, it may be due to cardiopulmonary cardiorespiratory arrest on day one and need for commencement or increase of vasopressor and hypertension. So how to minimize this deleterious effect? Antoine gave you some clue for that. But I will show you that you have to take into account as well the function of the left ventricle. If you apply a lung recruitment maneuver, so of course you will decrease the cardiac output. And due to two different effects, one is because you will decrease the right ventricular preload. You see that the CVP increase and then the venous return decrease. And you may increase the right ventricular afterload, and Antoine well demonstrated that. And you, if you look at the mean pulmonary artery, it increases, so the afterload of the right ventricle increase, decreasing the ejection of the right ventricle. That's why my proposal is to use a slow recruitment maneuver, which may minimize this decrease of cardiac output. That's why in our unit, despite the ART study, we continue to use this recruitment maneuver, even if we go lower. And of course, we stop this recruitment maneuver if we have any adverse effect. What happens, this is an old study by Cheryl Dash, in our department, demonstrated that during this recruitment maneuver, the cardiac output decreased, a very severe drop, but during the titration, fortunately, the cardiac output go back to the basal value. And of course, in this Mercado study that we did in our unit, we assess not only the right ventricular function during this recruitment maneuver, but as well the left ventricular systolic function. How? By checking the longitudinal strain, which is a good way to assess the true contractility of the left ventricle. And it is obvious here that during the recruitment maneuver, the true contraction, the contractility of the left ventricle is impaired. And again, fortunately, when we set the best PEEP, which was a little bit higher than the baseline PEEP, so the contractility returned to the baseline values. It means that the left ventricular systolic function could be impaired by a recruitment maneuver. This study with Pablo Mercado again, if you look at the respiratory system compliance during the recruitment maneuver, a dramatic drop, and but the P on F ratio, PAOT, increased dramatically at the same time. So what we did, we split the patient into responders and non-responders at the end of the recruitment maneuver. We check the P on F ratio, and if the P on F ratio increased by more than 50%, so it was a responder, and non-responder is lower than 50% of improvement of the P on F ratio. And one, what we discovered, that in non-responder patients, so the cardiac output dropped much more, maybe due to the fact that you did not open the lung and you induce an over-distension of the lung and compression of capillaries and much more effect on the cardiac output. And now here, if you look at these findings about left ventricular diastolic function and left ventricular systolic function, you see that in non-responder, you have a dramatic decrease of the left ventricular diastolic function and as well a dramatic decrease of the left ventricular systolic function when you compare with a patient who are responder to this recruitment maneuver. And you see that the compliance was related to this change of the diastolic and the systolic dysfunction of the left ventricle during the recruitment maneuver. As well, we calculated here the coronary perfusion pressure, and you see that during this recruitment maneuver, again, we have a dramatic drop of this coronary perfusion, and that's exactly what you asked previously to Antoine. So this is a new study that we performed, and we would like to compare the lung and the heart function at the same level of PEEP, but before the recruitment maneuver and after the recruitment maneuver, because of course the hypothesis is when you open the lung, so you will improve the hemodynamics, and of course at 25 centimeters of mercury after the recruitment maneuver, we expect to have a better function, right ventricular function and left ventricular function. Anyway, the compliance improved, the SpO2 improved, the P on F ratio improved at P25 after the recruitment maneuver. And now if you look at the left ventricular function, the left ventricular function improved at 25 centimeters of mercury after the recruitment maneuver. From my point of view, is because you opened the lung and because you decreased the over-distension of the alveoli and less compression of the heart. And look at that. If we split the patient with a higher compliance and lower change compliance, if you look at the left ventricular ejection fraction, so you have an improvement of the left ventricular ejection fraction when the compliance improves. So it means again that maybe it's due to the fact that you have less interaction between the lung and the heart. Now I would like to show you the study that we did. Thank you for this publication. I know that you got this paper for us, and so we did this study with in our unit, and the first author is Johan Zerbib. So it was possible to assess the coronary flow using the TOE and the pulsed continuous wave Doppler. We get a very nice flow, and here you can see this flow. It's a diastolic flow in the coronary left coronary artery, and usually on the right is much more right, much more systolic flow. And we recorded this flow at 5 centimeters of water of PEEP and at 15 centimeters of water of PEEP. And what we found, of course, the plateau pressure increase, the compliance decrease, the pulse pressure and the mean arterial pressure decrease, and the cardiac output as well. And then now, if you assess not only the cardiac output, but you assess the systolic function of the right ventricle, you have an impairment of the systolic of the right ventricular systolic function, as well as we had an impairment of the diastolic function of the left ventricle. Then, to summarize, a dysfunction, an impairment of the right ventricular function, an impairment of the diastolic function of the left ventricle. Which were the findings regarding the left coronary artery? when we increase the PEEP from 5 to 15, so we had a decrease of the aortic VTI, which is a flow during systole and during diastole, and which was a surprise for us is that we didn't find any relationship with a drop of the cardiac output at that time. And what about the right coronary artery? So we expect to have that, and we got that. So the systolic flow decreased and not the diastolic flow, which was a much smaller. Then, to conclude, a high PEEP is often used in patients with ARDS, of course, as well. A recruitment maneuver could be sometimes very helpful to open the lung and could be associated with a severe cardiac adverse effect, particularly in non-responder patients, but it is transient. That's very, very important to tell that. And the left ventricular systolic and diastolic function could be impaired when using high PEEP and during the recruitment maneuver, and high PEEP may decrease the coronary flow, inducing a diastolic dysfunction of the left ventricle and systolic dysfunction of the right ventricle. Then, when you use a high PEEP, of course, as all the people say during this session, please do a balance between the lung and the heart when you set the PEEP. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much for that fantastic presentation. Any questions from the audience? Luciano. Do you have a microphone by chance, or do you mind repeating it? Go ahead, please.
My problem is, what do you do after the recruitment? Let's say you recruit 40, 60, whatever you want. And then, what do you do?
So what do you do after the recruitment maneuver and for how long it is? Because if I recruit at 60 or 65, I can have all this kind of thing. But then if I set to have not overcap 30, in half an hour, I back exactly as before. So I...
We are doing exactly what you propose to do. Of course, we titrate the PEEP, and we try to find the best compliance and the best or the best P on F ratio. And then after that, we do again the recruitment maneuver. But we try to have a lower recruitment maneuver because, as you know, it could be dangerous. So, and we try to set the people at the level at which we have a decreased respiratory compliance and the decrease of P on F ratio. And of course, sometimes it stay for a few hours, and after that, we lose the effect of the recruitment maneuver on the lung. Yeah.
How often you check?
Usually we try to, about the heart of the lung or both, yeah. Usually we try to do it at least twice a day. We try to check for the heart and for the lung, at least because we know that, as you said, during over the time, so you may lose the effect of the recruitment maneuver. And of course, sometimes you may change as well the function of the heart, right ventricular dilation, as Antoine said. And then that's, I think that's very, very useful and very important to check the patient at least once a day or even twice a day. That's what we do, at least.
Right. Thank you so much for that excellent presentation. In the interest of time, we're going to move on to the next speaker. Thank you so much, Dr. Aslama.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure to introduce the last speaker for this session, who's going to tell us how to make sense of all this in a very succinct 15-minute presentation. Dr. Oriol Roca, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. Well, I have to confess that when I received the invitation for that lecture, I feel a little bit not very happy, let's say, because it's supposed that I have to take all the brains of the people that have speak before me, put it on a box, merge in a single equation, and give you the box that you can go back to their unit, and then you have the magic formula to set the best PEEP at the bedside. And this is impossible. But then I'm a Barca supporter, and long time ago, when we won everything, not now, there was a player, a little one, I know, I'm sure that you know that him, now he's playing in the US, and he was supported by a company, and the slogan of the company was, "Nothing is impossible." So I thought maybe we could try something, not putting all together, but giving you the bullet points or useful tricks that you can use at the bedside in order to improve your PEEP setting. These are my conflicts of interest, and I have to say that when I think about PEEP setting is something like the never-ending story. My father was an intensivist, and 40 years ago, you said, you were discussing about the same. Now there are new tools that improve the discussion, maybe, I don't know, but I think that at the end of the road, I don't know if we will arrive today. So what about PEEP setting on controlled mechanical ventilation? And I just want to introduce you a case, 50-year-old female with a pneumonia and D6-ray. And as soon as she arrived to the unit, she was intubated, FiO2 of 1, PEEP of 8, driving pressure of 18 with a plateau pressure of 30. And then with this gas exchange that you can see here, PO2 of 65. So close to the Eolia criteria for ECMO. And then we went to the CT, and this was the image that we get. And the first thing that we thought is, this is fully closed, and I don't know if I will be able to open. But the first thing that we did is low flow PV curve in order to assess if there was any opening airway pressure. So this was the reasoning to move or to increase this PEEP, at least to try to open this part. And after a few hours, the PV loop looks completely different. I'm not saying that you have to keep PEEP of 18 for this for much more time. The lung is already open. Maybe you can decrease the PEEP because the pressure that you need to open is probably much higher than the pressure that you need to keep what is already open. But this was the first step that we did at that time. And as Professor Gattinoni said, PEEP might not be related with lung recruitability. And as you can see there, regardless of the level of PEEP, the amount of lung tissue that you are able to open does not increase. Increase a little bit with the superimposed pressure that you have on top of the collapsed lung. There are other tools that could be assessed to know if there is some kind of potential for recruitment. Laurent has described this in his presentation, just to decrease by 10 centimeters of water of PEEP and see the exhale tidal volume in the second exhalation. You can know if the compliance of the baby lung is, and the ratio of the compliance of the baby lung and the recruited lung is above or below certain threshold. And according to that, you may assume if your patient would benefit from higher PEEP, which nobody knows what it means, or with lower PEEP, which nobody knows what it means. But at least, if you are a high recruiter, you might be close to 15, and if you are a low recruiter, you might be close to 5 to 10, let's say. And then Ewan told us about driving pressure. And driving pressure is a global measurement of the size of the lung, let's say, and any change in driving pressure that you may observe is a balance between what happens inside the lung in terms of recruitment that may decrease driving pressure and overdistension that may increase driving pressure. But he showed us that if you change the driving pressure, any increase in driving pressure according to the change in the ventilatory settings after the randomization in the EXPRESS and the alveoli trial was associated with a higher probability of death. By contrast, when you change ventilatory settings and there is a decrease in driving pressure, you are less likely to die. This does not mean, as he says, this association does not mean causality. And he is now testing this hypothesis in the practical trial that show us. And let's talk about esophageal pressure. This is the trial that she showed about patients on ECMO. And when they set PEEP according to the expiratory transpulmonary pressure, they use a higher PEEP, but there was also a decrease in the driving pressure, linked to what Ivan said before. And this was associated with a higher probability of being weaned from ECMO and lower mortality even 6 months after the critical illness. So it was quite consistent. And this is the highest evidence by using esophageal pressure to titrate PEEP in ARDS patients. This is the post-hoc analysis of the EBBEN II trial. Remember that the EBBEN II trial allow you to set PEEP between 0 and 5 or transpulmonary expiratory pressure. And maybe it was a wide range. And they hypothesized that between 2 and 5, you are at high risk of over-distending the lung. So they divide the population in 3 groups. The one that was around 0, above 2 with high risk of hyperdistension, and below 2 with high risk of collapse. And the ones that were more likely to survive are the ones that you keep transpulmonary pressure around 0. And Laurent showed how EIT could be used. EIT, in that sense, could divide patients according their recruitability. And interestingly, allow us to apply low levels of PEEP in low recruiters compared to higher levels of PEEP around 15 or 16 in high recruiters. But more importantly, compare what with the compliance method, the best compliance method. When you use EIT-based PEEP, you change in more than 80% of the cases the PEEP level that you are using. So it may change clinical practice. But EIT could be used in another way, and I want you only to present a case. This is a case of a patient that was on VA ECMO, and he has this complete atelectasis of the left lung. I will summarize the case, but of course we did an echo to be sure that there was no hemothorax and so on, but it was an atelectasis, so we performed a bronchoscopy. We removed the clots that were in the main left bronchi, and then we start ventilating the left lung, but then we perform an EIT-based PEEP. And if we were thinking about the strategy of using the crossing point, the PEEP that we might be used would be around 14. But this was not our aim in this case. I fully agree with Professor Gattinoni that we have to individualize our decisions according to the patients that we are facing with. And our aim in that case was to keep the left lung open, even though we were knowing that we were over-distending the right lung. But the only way that we had to wean this patient from ECMO is to have both lungs because he was hypoxemic. So we decide to apply a PEEP in between these two phases because this is a regional map of over-distension and collapse. So we don't want this blue zone. So we keep in between these two. We put a PEEP of 18 And you will see with how progressively the left lung was improving in terms of its ventilation. And it was far from the crossing point. In fact, 4 centimeters of water above the crossing point. But the aim here was to keep the left lung open in order to win the patient from ECMO. And this is the forgotten part from all the people who, like me, like physiology, which is the biology. The same driving pressure could have, or the same PEEP level could have a different response according to the level of inflammation that you have. And this is the first paper from the group of San Francisco, from Caroline Calfi, demonstrating that the higher PEEP strategy may decrease mortality in those patients who are highly inflammated, but may increase mortality in those patients with low levels of inflammation. So it can be used to, as a predictive enrichment strategy in order to design future randomized controlled trials in order to individualize at some point the treatment and provide the right strategy to the right patient. And this is a pragmatic approach that was published some years ago. I like the term of better PEEP because I think that the best PEEP does not exist. The better is what can be considered as a reasonable compromise between oxygenation, hemodynamics, as we have seen in the last two presentations, and the avoidance of atelectasis trauma. And this atelectasis trauma is what depends on recruitability, which at the same time is correlated with the severity of ARDS. And therefore, maybe we can stratify only the PEEP that the patient is receiving according to the severity of ARDS. But there is another strategy that was published by one of our chairmen based on the PEEP response, which for me makes a lot of sense because the only way to know how your patient responds to different levels of PEEP is to test it. So if you perform a PEEP test by increasing PEEP or by decreasing PEEP using the recruitment to inflation ratio, and then you will know what happens in the variables that you are controlling, not only respiratory variables, but also hemodynamic variables, you may decide if the patient would benefit from higher PEEP or lower PEEP levels. And of course, there are some patients that might be complex. And with these more advanced monitoring tools, you may have much more information in order to take the right decision in the right moment at the bedside. That could not be the same in every day. One patient may need PEEP of 8 one day and PEEP of 12 another day. But for sure, 12 is not the best PEEP for the whole lung. It's the PEEP that the patient needs at that moment to obtain the best compromise between oxygenation, hemodynamics, and avoiding atelectasis trauma. And this is what the evidence say, and I fully agree what have been said before. This is a network meta-analysis that drives some guidelines, decisions, and what they say is that higher PEEP without prolonged recruitment maneuvers is superior to lower PEEP, but this is the average treatment effect of all the randomized control trials that has been included in this meta-analysis, which does not mean that the patient that you have on your bed would benefit from higher PEEP, which nobody knows what it means. And yeah, just two slides. And another topic is what happens when the patient starts triggering the ventilator, because then all that we have seen is under controlled mechanical ventilation. If PEEP is good, the patient would decrease the effort. This is the esophageal pressure swings. As soon as you increase PEEP, the lung is mechanically better, let's say, and then the patient needs less effort to breathe than compared with the levels of lower PEEP. And Ewan make a very nice study, because if you don't have an esophageal balloon, how can I know if my patient could benefit or not from higher PEEP or not? So what they saw is that if you increase PEEP and then compliance decrease, you are more likely to decrease esophageal pressure and lung distending pressure. So you are more likely to be protecting the lung. So it's a simple test, just increase PEEP and see what happens. If the compliance go down, it means that probably the effort will go down and the distending pressure will also go down. So just to finalize, the best PEEP does not exist. I'm sorry for all of you, but this is the real world. And the other thing is that in all randomized control trials that have been done, I think that no one strategy has been demonstrated to be superior than another, probably because we are mixing patients. We are seeing average treatment effect, not the individual treatment effect. We have seen a very nice presentation in the opening session about oxygenation targets. This is the way we should improve our practice. And then, of course, we need to individualize the approach. The coffee for all is not good. Someone may like tea, others want milk, and someone will like orange juice. Everybody needs liquid, but everybody needs PEEP. But which level of PEEP is something that we still don't know. And we have to balance between benefits and harms, and it depends on the clinical expertise and judgment that you have. Thank you very much, and I will be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Oriol. This is a fantastic perspective on this very interesting session. I'm afraid we have to close this session.